You feel that.
You know, that version is a lot better, I think. I'm telling you. It's funny. Anyway, I just wanted to put it out there, of course. Listen, it's another Sunday night edition of Annulment Proof, the only place on YouTube where marriage gets defined. This week, I saw this video from a guy named Devin Schott. I've never heard of the guy. He's a contributor for Catholic Gentlemen and stuff, and he was just machine gunning, throwing out these hardcore boomer JP2 personalistic norm, no marital debt stuff. I was like, man, I got to talk about this one. It's not that it's just he's so orthodox in his JP2 isms and his procreation secondary stuff. It needs to be contradicted. So let's listen to him for a minute, and then I'm gonna try to go through it. He's fast. It's not a long video, but I got to push pause a lot. Sorry about that. And then we'll go through some show notes. Let's see if I can find him. Here we go. Okay, we'll put it on halfway here, like a little. Oh, we've got to get rid of that one. Let's share this tab instead. Cool. All right, Devin, excuse me. Take it away. Right on. Let's go. Make me a little bit bigger, I guess. All right, here we go.
What's wrong with lusting for my wife? After all, I'm not lusting after another woman, right? St. Paul says that marriage is a remedy for concupiscence.
That's true. Of course, marriage is a remedy for concupiscence, but not anymore, because the whole premise of this video this guy has is that procreation has been replaced with the person as far as the primary purpose. Let's continue.
Therefore, my wife, properly speaking, should be an outlet for my sexual desires, right? At least I'm not committing adultery. Well, Caravatiwa, the man who became...
At least he's not committing adultery. I gotta turn up my own volume. Hang on a second. Yeah, adultery. Okay, so the problem with... Well, hang on. Let's just back up and see what he said for a second.
Properly speaking, should be an outlet for my sexual desires, right? At least I'm not committing adultery. Well, Caravatiwa, the man who became Pope John Paul II, in his book Love and Responsibility, proposed the idea of the personalistic norm.
So JP2 proposed the idea of the personalistic norm. That's new, novel, never before heard. We're talking about a redefinition of marriage. That's what it is. That's all this is, which is why we have super confusion. Okay. Marriage has become subjective because of this personalistic norm. Move over procreation, move over law, move over objectivity. Make way for the personalistic norm that no one knows what it is exactly. Okay, here.
The personalistic norm is that people are not to be used as objects. Persons are the type of good that can only be properly related to through love.
Fine. Everyone needs charity. Charity is supposed to be everywhere with everybody. Okay, but the definition of marriage isn't necessarily a charity thing. I didn't put that right. Charity, like I said, it covers everything, but the definition of marriage legally doesn't include charity.
So in other words, people are not to be used as a means to an end.
People are not to be used as a means to an end. He said the word end. He is saying that the end of marriage, effectively the primary end, is the personalistic norm, aka the person, okay, love, whatever. So the right over the body was the primary for procreation. Now it's the right over the person, and the person doesn't necessarily procreate. Okay. It's not the primary. That's why we have this issue.
Now, the personalistic norm may sound like a trite Christian platitude, but let's examine this on a practical level. So you're working overtime for your employer. Your paycheck comes in. Not only did he not pay you for your overtime, but he deducted money from your check.
Okay. So this is a dumb analogy, I think. But anyway, he's saying, look, you have a contract to work, and your employer is not paying you what you're owed. So obviously that is unjust. It's not going to feel good.
For the better of the company.
Okay, so he's doing it for the better of the company. You could say, I'm going to not provide the marital debt for the good of the spouses. Same thing. You can flip this script every which way. This is all, this is like his whole thing. This whole video is like an anti-man video. That's what it is. It's a pro-simp thing.
Your employer uses you as a means to the good end of having a fiscally successful, lucrative company.
Right. What if one spouse uses you for the good end of a successful marriage and they're just using you? They're operating unjustly, okay, by refusing the marital debt for the good of the spouses. It's the same thing. You can just flip it on its head.
Company. Do you like the way that feels? A coworker discovers that you're friends with a well-known personality. Your coworker befriends you. You go out for lunches, drinks after work, and this goes on for months. And then he pops the question. He asks if he could meet your popular friend. So you introduce them. They begin to hang out, but without you. They instead become friends, and you're left out. Do you like the way that feels?
Who cares? If you don't want to be left out, why don't you do whatever it takes? I mean, is this stupid? Of course. You know, that's so dumb. Sorry. I don't even need to comment on it. It's too dumb. I need to get one other thing on the screen. Hold on a second. Okay, let's go through a few show notes here and try to keep up. So this is the first Bible verse when he says, St. Paul says, remedy for concupiscence. But if they do not, 1 Corinthians, but if they do not contain themselves, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to be burnt. Okay. Okay, so if they do not contain themselves, therefore, if they decide not to be a nun or a priest because they have made a choice, then they can get married, okay? So, and the Douay Rheims is so good because it gives commentary. If they do not contain, this is spoken of such as are free, meaning they're willing, they can choose whether they want to contain themselves or not, not that they don't have any control. Such as a vow, like I said, a religious vow, have given their faith first to God, whom blah, 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 blah. God will never, okay. Some translators, my cat is dying to get in here. You'll have to wait, little kitty cat. Some translators, maybe we can get him. Hold on a second. Let me just get him in here. Well, he chickened out. I don't know. I heard him scratching like crazy into the door. Anyhow, yes. Some translators have corrupted this text by rendering it if they cannot contain. See that? And here we go. Let's go to the USCCB Bible, the New American Bible Revised Edition. But if they cannot exercise self-control, they should marry. So the real Bible says if they do not contain, but USCCB says if they cannot contain. And the reason why that's important is because the remedy of concupiscence is not disordered. It is a right in marriage, as long as it's well, is properly ordered. And they are saying that it's just lust is just something that's bad and you can't control it. Or there's a reason why they changed that in the Bible. About show notes. So you've heard this a few times. The primary end of marriage is procreation. The secondary end is mutual help and the allaying of concupiscence. So it's not disordered as long as it is ordered with procreation primary. Okay. Let's go over another. What is the marriage contract? This is something that the Devin Shat guy, I don't think he catches on to. A consent is the act of the will by each party gives and accepts perpetual right over the body, not the soul, not the self, not the person, but the body for acts which are themselves suitable for the generation of children. Pretty simple stuff. All right. There's more show notes, but we'll go back to the, Devin here. See what we got. Here we go. Hang on. Let me here share this tab instead. Okay.
Nobody likes being used. It runs against our nature. It's
Nobody likes being used. However, marriage is a contract. So when you are, let's say if you're working for an employer, you're not being used. You're getting a paycheck for what you did. You know, so the husband has to work all the time. Is he being used by the wife? She has to have babies. Is she being used by the husband? No, it's part of the contract, part of the agreement.
It's about perspective. A man believes that lusting after his wife is acceptable because he is the one benefiting from using her.
Dog, it's not using your spouse for natural relations. Unless you change the primary purpose of marriage from procreation to self, which is exactly what you're doing. I don't know if you're a boomer or not. You look kind of Gen X like me, but cat, chill on the scratching, please. Okay. Come on. Anyway, here we go.
But when another person uses that guy, he becomes embittered and resentful. Men who fail to see the problem with lusting for their wives prove that they're incapable of considering their wives' perspective.
Let me think about that. Wait, what did he just say?
Of considering their wives' perspective.
Yeah, whatever. Okay, hang on.
Perspective. They lack compassion. They witness to their own narcissism.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah, narcissism. So if marriage is not procreation, but marriage is self, then anyone who asserts any type of rights is a narcissist. Therefore, the marriage is invalid because someone's a narcissist when they assert their rights. And the only people that assert the rights are the husband, typically, because they always work and stuff. You know, otherwise, I guess the wife could be accused of being a narcissist if she says, I'm staying home with the kids and you have to work. And that's, what is that, just narcissistic? Crazy, man. All right. This is Hocus Focus, P-H-O-C-A-S, named after Saint Focus. And he cannot hold still, so he's got to be where the action is. All right, let's keep going. Here we go.
They can only see how they can benefit from the situation. So why is lust bad? Well, first, lust separates the body from the soul.
That's a new one on me. Separates, like I said, if lust separates the body from the soul, that would be to say there is the, like I said, if the primary purpose of marriage is the self, then you are disordered in the conjugal act if it's for lust. Okay. But if the primary purpose is procreation, as long as you don't use any method to not procreate, then, you know. Here, let's see.
So when you look at someone with lust, you're separating their body from their person, from their soul. So lust appropriates the body. It uses the body for one's disordered personal gratification.
Okay, so he is saying that the conjugal act is disordered if it's not for the personalistic norm, which is something new that Carol Wojtyła introduced out of nowhere, because love was in the air in the 20th century and the Protestants were going big on contraception. So the Catholics had to catch up, and Dietrich von Hildebrand and all those guys there, they were pushing it too. So who could say, you know, I just don't want this love. The problem is you start making love wins and then you got a problem with the definition of marriage. And now you have Devin Shatt here going off on educating everybody on the wrong. He's just like a guy feminist. That's what he is.
At the expense of the interior desires of the other person. So lust ignores.
So sorry to stop so much, but he goes so freaking fast, and I think he's created a script or something. Hang on.
Gratification at the expense of the interior desires of the other person.
So traditionally, contraception is wrong because you are using the conjugal act at the expense or independent of procreation. This guy is saying that lust is wrong because you are using the marriage act at the expense of the other person. So it's not about procreation anymore. It's the personalistic norm is the primary. Hang on.
So lust ignores the person and uses them as an object for sexual gratification.
Well, not to beat it up too bad here, but yes, if the person is the primary purpose, then he's got a point. But he's wrong because it's not, it's procreation.
But what are the consequences of lust? I mean, is it really a big deal? Well, first, lust restrains a man in boyhood. He never matures.
Yeah. When you look at the Bible, you type in lust, it's got like 57 entries, but all of them are independent of marriage. All of them. Okay.
He never outgrows selfishness. He fails to love another for their own sake, which is really what love is, to love another for their own sake, for their own good. He doesn't train himself to love disinterestedly. That's without self-interest. The second consequence is that lust separates love from sacrifice. The essence of a real man is sacrifice. The men on Normandy Beach on D-Day, the father who jumps into a well to save his son who fell into the well, the father dies. the man who throws himself in front of a car to save a woman, or Jesus Christ, who hangs on a cross and takes sin upon him in our place so that we can be released from our sin and the consequences of those sins. These are real men, ultimately Christ. They fulfilled their essence of self-sacrifice. That's the meaning of a real man. But lust rips the man away from his essence. It conditions a man to only think of his own self-benefit. So when
independent of marriage, yeah, but you're allowed, obviously, within... Okay, so let's go back to the show notes for a second here, bro. Hang on. Share this tab instead. Groovy. All right, here. Oh, here's this personalistic norm stuff, by the way. This is Gaudium et Spes, where it kind of got going. Human procreation in the context of true love. That reminds me of Princess Bride, right? True love. Yeah, groovy. Okay, so... the new primary purpose is the personalistic norm, quote, true love. That's the basis of marriage after Vatican II. It's a redefinition. But everyone thinks it sounds so great. Just like saying, oh, I don't know. Well, let's ban guns. That way everybody will be safe. And what you get is a whole bunch more dead people and violence. See what I'm saying? Okay, well, let's make love legal. That way we'll have better marriages. All you have is a bunch more divorce. That's what you get. Because marriage has no definition. So now he's talking about this disordered lust, blah, blah, blah. All right. Cassidy Canubi. Okay. Foreign matrimony, as well as the use of matrimonial rites, which are defined, by the way. And after Vatican II, they're not defined because no one can do it because you can't put love in a box or define it. You know, there are secondary ends, such as mutual aid, cultivating of love, and the quieting of concupiscence, bro. Which the husband and wife are not forbidden to consider. So it's totally cool as long as they are subordinated to the primary end. I wonder what the primary end is. It's procreation, as we found out earlier. Here it is. Yeah. Primary end of marriage is procreation. It's not the personalistic norm, but he says it is. Whoops. Hang on a second. He says it is the personalistic norm. That's his problem. That's why he's all confused. You have to get rid of all lust because the self is number one. So long as the intrinsic nature of the act is preserved. Yeah. Okay. Now let's go back to, this is one place in the Bible where procreation primary comes from. That's when Tobit marries Sarah. And now, Lord, knowest not for fleshly lust do I take my sister to wife, but only for the love of posterity. So they had a valid marriage. It was for procreation alone. It wasn't for the self or her person or any of that stuff. Okay. And then here we go. And this is the quote of this whole talk. Whoever shall look on a woman with lust after her already committed adultery with her in his heart. However, because marriage is... you have to consent to marriage. There's no, you cannot commit adultery with somebody who you've already consented with. All right. So they're your wife. So this is why you can't lust after your own wife and commit adultery with her, nor can you rape your own wife because there's already consent. You can commit sin. Oh, by the way, let me get back to that rape thing in a minute because everyone's going to hate that. It's a venial sin to pursue the conjugal act for the flesh only. But if you use a method to make sure it's only about the flesh, like NFP, then that is mortal sin. Okay. So you have to have procreation primary. But, and again, back to marital rape, because rape requires no consent, it's impossible to legally rape your wife because there has already been consent. Just like you cannot commit adultery with your wife. All right, let's see what else he's got to say here. Hang on a second. We're almost to the end here. Boop, boop. Share this. Okay.
When his wife is fatigued, stressed, overwhelmed, or just fearful of becoming pregnant again, and she wants to postpone intercourse.
What if the husband is stressed, fatigued, and just doesn't, or the husband, and just doesn't want to work anymore, but she's telling him he has to? You know, it's like you can just flip every single example he has.
But he whines, he grumbles, he complains.
What if she whines, she grumbles, she complains that he needs to get to work, but he just needs a break? Do you think that she's being narcissistic because she wants him to go to work so she can stay home with the kids.
And sometimes coerces her, even invoking the marriage debt.
Dog, the marriage debt is the basis of the whole contract. It's right in the Bible, okay? But anyway, it's like this is like simp 101 here.
So he can have intercourse with her. He fails to sacrifice himself for her.
All right, fine. If you want to have it that way, then if she's failing to sacrifice herself for him, it works both ways. While I'm thinking about this, people say love is required for marriage validity. If that's true, then wifely submission is required for marriage validity, which it's not. Okay, those are things that husbands should love their wives and wives must submit. But those aren't part of the. That's not the marriage contract. Validity does not hinge on that. Okay.
The third consequence is this: your wife will eventually despise you.
The third. What's the third consequence of the husband who doesn't work? Then the wife will eventually despise him.
A wife eventually resents her lustful husband. She knows that he is using her.
If you keep listening to you, sorry, knucklehead, and with this all this JP2 personalistic norm rot, she's going to think she's getting used because it's all this self-worship person stuff. And marriage, like you said, you're redefining marriage. So it turns into self-worship.
And she grows to despise him for it.
Yeah. Do you think that the husband would grow to despise his wife if she doesn't honor the marital debt? It works both ways. So it's the only way to do this is to have a clear definition of marriage that's objective with rights. Otherwise, it's like, you give me $1 million. No, you give me $1 million. Well, we'll both see. There's a reason why good friends make good neighbors, and a good contract makes a good marriage. When you blow the contract up and just say, let's all have a big love fest, then nobody knows what they have to do because push comes to shove a lot.
She may comply with her body, but interiorly, she's resenting and recoiling from him.
What if he has to go to work all the time? He may comply with his body, but interiorly, he's resenting his wife because she's making him go to work. Oh, brother. She has a right to stay home with the kids, so he's got to get to work. He is saved through the sweat of his brow. She's saved through childbearing. That's it. Because of the fall, my man.
The fourth consequence is that your wife won't respect you, regardless of how good you think you are in bed.
Your wife won't respect you. Let's see. I'm thinking about that. Let's flip that again on the script. Okay. So if the wife won't respect you, if you appeal to the marital debt, is the husband going to respect the wife if she says you need to get out and work? Oh, I don't respect you because you're not respecting my person. I have feelings and needs and I'm tired and I don't want to work right now. And I know we don't have any money, but I feel like you just need to give me some time and I need you to respect me. And I'm going to resent you if you make me go to work.
Your wife sees you as a boy and not a man. You're unwilling to sacrifice for her, and therefore you're whining, you're complaining. Remind her of one of her toddlers.
Yeah, well, the sacrifice works both ways, but the good news is sacrifice and selflessness is not the legal basis of marriage, okay? Those are all Christian virtues, charity, okay? But we need to define what this is. Otherwise, I could go to your house, Devin, and say, let me have all the food in your refrigerator. And if you don't give it to me, it's because you don't care about my person and you're just selfish and you're using it. You know, it's like, no, because there's boundaries. There's a definition of who owns what and what's for what.
And therefore her level of respect for you diminishes greatly. The fifth consequence is that you have no self-respect, no respect for yourself.
Oh, brother, man, this guy. I guess if you're looking at porn or something, your self-respect is going to go down. But if you're just having a bunch of kids, you know, as long as you can provide for them, you're doing that part right. Okay. That's the key thing. That's the nuts and bolts there.
You interiorly have no respect for yourself because you know that you're not a real man. So the actual teaching of Jesus Christ, he says, whoever looks at a woman to lust has committed adultery in his heart. And so the objection is this. Yeah, see, by lusting after my own wife, I'm not committing adultery with another woman. Well, there's two things to consider. First, Jesus says, when we look at a woman. So he's saying all women, including a man's wife.
Wrong. Buzzer. No. Your wife has consented to the conjugal act for life. That, let's go back to the, what do you call it? Dude, basics, okay? Where is it? Hold on. Matrimonial consent. Each party gives and accepts a perpetual and exclusive right over the body. That's it. That's there. Okay, I forgot what I was talking about. Let's go back to him. Sorry. Maybe we'll back up a little bit, get rolling again.
When we look at a woman, so he's saying all women, including a man's wife. And second, when a man lusts after his wife, he actually is committing adultery.
Now there's a mouthful when he's, okay, let's just, when he's committing adultery. Hang on.
After his wife, he actually is committing adultery in a way. He's having sex with her body while not loving her person.
So it's adultery for the conjugal act if you're not loving the person, but the conjugal act is the body. So no one can say what loving the person is legally, number one. Number two, that's not the primary purpose, okay? So it's not adultery because as long as the, let's go back to basics. Boom, here we go. Hold on. Okay. As long as we get back to the proper order of things, so you can do all the secondary ends as long as it's subordinated to the primary end, which is procreation. Oh, brother.
He is using her in a very real way. In a very real way, he is cheating on her soul.
Homie, it's not cheating on somebody's soul. We are the 1 Corinthians 7:5, do not defraud over the body, but no one has a right to the person or a right to the soul. That is you cannot change the essence of marriage, but that's exactly what you're doing because I don't know, for political reasons or all this, it's really NFP, because if you want to keep NFP legal, you have to have a primary purpose. That's not procreation. Obviously you're doing the marriage act for some other reason, the personalistic norm. You've got to have personalistic norm as primary if you're going to have NFP as licit, and ain't no one going to touch NFP with a 10-foot pole. So we now marriage is being held hostage. Now you got apologists like boomer apologists here, like Devin Chat. By the way, I commented a bunch on this video and he like barely got back to me, and I asked him if he could do a video or something. He's like going zeros on me. I'll put the link to the video too and the other stuff here. Hang on.
While using her body to gratify himself. The scripture says that Saint Joseph was unwilling to expose Mary, his wife, to shame. Joseph protected Mary from himself.
I don't even know why he's bringing Saint Joseph up. It makes no sense. Adultery was bad. And so he wanted to not let Mary get stoned. So he was going to keep it quiet. That's all it was.
The possibility of having any disordered sexual desire for Mary. He offered himself for her. In the words of Christ, this is my body given for you. And as Paul in Romans 12:1 says, we're to offer our bodies as a holy and living sacrifice unto the Lord. This is your spiritual worship. If you and I, if we were to be real men like Christ and like Saint Joseph, if we were to live from our essence of sacrificial responsibility to sacrifice ourselves for another, we are to defeat lust in the heart. We are to offer ourselves on the altars of our beds and pray. This is
offer yourself on the altar of your bed. Obviously, that cuts both ways. So if she's refusing, she's not offering herself. And if he's refusing, he's not offering himself. Okay. So you can't say, gee, this is just lust. Okay. It's the rite of marriage, my man.
This is my body given for you.
Yeah. This is all this spiritualizing of marriage. It's all this infinite dignity stuff. Marriage is not like the Eucharist. because God gave himself for us, but marriage is just the right over the body. It's a different deal.
And usually a wife whose husband loves her in this way desires to reciprocate that offering.
I don't know about that, because typically what he's talking about is just simp 101. So women tend to not like simps. They come to resent them eventually because they're not manning up. They're not asserting themselves or doing what they need to do. They're just like, yes, dear, whatever you want. I'm going to be like Adam and not make Eve unhappy, because we need to find the pinnacle of the personalistic norm. And I think, from what I gather, it's counterintuitive. When you give the wife whatever she wants, you get dumped off the cliff.
By offering, yes, her body, but her entire self in return to him.
Whatever, bro. I think we've hit that enough. I guess that's the end of it. Holy cow.
What's wrong with lusting for my wife?
Hold on a second. Hold on. Let's go to let's finish up and see if we got any show notes that we haven't finished yet. Anything else I wanted to say? No. You know what? I think that's it. I think that this is the part of the show where we dance. That's what I think.
Your mama. Your mama. That's right. I said your mama. Your mama. Your mama. That's right, I said your mama. Your mama. Your mama. That's right, I said your mama. Your mama.
Yo, man, check us out. I hate to talk about your bad, but you blow my mind. Sometimes the things you do are way out of line. You like to put me down.